Niagara Region Public Health used mobile data throughout this pandemic to help stop the spread. Our Hamilton-Niagara, Ontario Hub's journalist, Justin Chandler, has been looking into what they've learned and how it might help as we reopen. And he joins us now from Hamilton. Hey, Justin.
Hey there.
All right, so how does mobility data collection work?
So basically, everyone's phone is able to broadcast location information, or information sometimes about their location or their intention to travel. And so this data comes from that. So when we talk about mobility data reports in relation to COVID-19, these are often big aggregated data sets that either show a lot of location data about where people have been going, or can be based off of things like map searches, which would show an intention to travel.
Now, some people who are probably listening to you right now might be freaked out that, oh my God, I'm being tracked. Should there be any concerns at all for that?
Well, I guess I would say you are being tracked and you could be concerned about that. But in this case, it's anonymized data. And so it's more saying like a lot of people might be going somewhere. It's not saying you specifically are going somewhere. So while I would add the caveat that yes, your phone could be giving specific information about your location to different providers, that's not what this is. So if you're concerned, check out your privacy policies and settings to see what you're giving information to.
All right, so in regards to this data, how exactly are public health units using it and obtaining it?
So as far as this, like I said, some of this is publicly available. So Apple puts forth its own sort of report based on map searches. Google puts something out based on location history, which is a setting that people have to turn on. But these are publicly available reports that public health can then look at and analyze. They can also get a little bit more information from those providers. And then there's also private companies that do, for example, marketing research or modeling that can take this information or additional location information and analyze that. So public health is able to look at all of these and get reports about how many people are going around and the locations that they might be visiting.
All right, so let's show two examples of how people are moving around. First, this is data collected by Apple about the way Ontarians are moving about. Can you describe what we're seeing on this graph?
So what we've got here is Apple's mobility trends report looking for the full province. And this actually starts in January 2020 before the pandemic was declared. And the movement that you see there, that's the baseline. So that's that movement in that period in the winter leading up to March. So as you can see, based on this chart, it starts out, it's flat at the baseline. And then in March, once the pandemic is declared and new restrictions come in, people are told to stay home, things actually start to shift quite dramatically. So you've got the red line is for driving. There's an orange line for walking. Those two are pretty closely associated. So they take a significant dip. And then eventually they start to peak up as things go towards the summer. And then there's a purple line for transit. That one also drops this one even more. And it actually stays well below the baseline throughout the pandemic. It's currently sitting at 53% less mobility on transit than before, whereas driving and walking are actually now up above. And so a couple interesting things about this. One of them, you'll notice that things move with the season, but they also move with pandemic trends. So for each surge of COVID-19, where more cases came in and more restrictions came in, you'll see a drop. And then as things got better and weather gets nicer, generally, we're seeing increases. So that's why we've got sort of a valley, followed by a peak, followed by a valley, and now we're heading towards another peak.
All right, now let's zone in on Niagara. This data is collected from Google. It looks like parks are quite busy lately, which is being shown in the blue line there. Can you describe these trends for us?
Yes. So for here, this data starts in April. We've got the baseline there, which again, this is from Google, but it's that same sort of pre-pandemic period. And so, as you said, with parks, we've got that blue line. And we can see that in April, we were sort of hovering around the baseline. And then as weather gets nicer and more outdoor things start to open up, we have a long weekend in there, people start to go out to parks much more. And now we're at 122% increase over the baseline period. With groceries and pharmacy stores, which are the red line, we can see that we've been above the baseline for the most part since April. We're at about 26% more mobility heading to those locations. And then again, transit stations well below in Niagara, below 50% of the baseline, and they're currently sitting at 57% less mobility when the data was last captured.
Now, you spoke to some experts for your article to help interpret these trends. Can you give us a sample of what they had to say?
So one of those trends is, like I mentioned, it seems that each major intervention to reduce mobility has actually done less than the previous thing. But we're also seeing that as the weather seems to be getting nicer, there are a lot more people doing outdoor activities. We're also seeing more people going to retail and more people generally going to residential addresses. These are sort of some of the major trends that we're seeing. And some things that they pointed out are that mobility overall is perhaps the best indicator that we do have of transmission. So epidemiologist Colin Furness was telling me that they track very closely, and it's unfortunate in a sense, he says, because mobility data, we know it correlates with transmission, but it doesn't actually tell us anything about safety. So you can know, for example, that 122% more people are going to the park, but it doesn't tell you if they're physically distancing. It doesn't tell you if they're kissing strangers. You have no idea actually based on just that information of what's going on. We do still know, though, that they emphasize again that mobility generally means more transmission. It's more opportunity to come into contact with people. And we have been seeing throughout the pandemic that when that goes up, so too tends to transmission.
And of course, as of today, people in Ontario will be able to travel around. Does that mean that we should?
So this is another one where it gets a little complicated. So I asked Dr. Mustafa here, he's Niagara's acting medical officer of health, about this. There's been a lot of concern in Niagara about travel. What has been tending to happen is that whenever there's a spike in cases in Toronto or Peel, in a couple of weeks that happens in Niagara. The implication being that people are traveling there and spreading the virus. And that's been going on throughout the pandemic. But he pointed out that yes, the stay-at-home order is ending, reopening is starting. And of course, Niagara's economy is incredibly centered on tourism. So they actually do need travelers to come in there for that reason. So what this does mean is that people need to be careful if they are going out, that they're following public health orders and they're following the proper guidelines. So for example, he said, maybe it's okay if you come to a beach in Niagara, maybe that's low risk, you're outside, but if everyone is going to that beach, it's really crowded and there's no distancing, it's probably not a good idea for you to be there. And there's probably still a high risk of transmission, even if you're vaccinated.
And he did have this great analogy to sort of explain to people, who may not be getting the message. Can you sort of explain that one?
Yes, this was Dr. Furness's analogy, but he talked about, basically he said that vaccines make you disease resistant, or in this case, COVID-19 resistant, in the same way that your watch might be water resistant. So while you could maybe take that watch for a swim or take it in the shower, if you go deep sea diving, it's going to break. And in the same way, he said that this is how vaccines work. So maybe you have some more mobility now that you've got some resistance. Maybe you can start to see a few more people. But if you're doing a lot of that, you're greatly increasing the chance that you're going to pick something up and perhaps pass it on to somebody else, maybe someone who doesn't have the same protection that you do. It's also important to note here that the variant that is growing in Ontario, often called the Delta variant or the B.1.617 strain, is something that if you only have one dose of vaccine, it can still actually be able to infect you. So one dose is not the most effective at preventing you getting sick from this variant. Two doses is better. So most people in Ontario are still quite at risk from this.
Some very good information. Thank you for that. Now, Justin, I do want to shift gears a bit. This week, you also spoke to Dr. Javid Sukera. He is the outgoing chair of the London Police Board, about the London truck attack. And he had this very powerful quote where he said, "Your silence will not protect you." That was in your article for TVO.org. What was your takeaway from that conversation?
Well, we did have a very powerful conversation, I think. And what he was really trying to emphasize to people is that this allegedly Islamophobic attack is based in Islamophobia that happens in Canada all the time. So when he talked about silence, this was specifically his comment directed towards Canadians who aren't Muslim. And what he was saying was that while Muslim people need to stand up, be deliberate, still be Muslim, and don't hide in the face of this violence, the rest of us need to make sure that we're stepping up and we're actually confronting Islamophobia. He talked about how in Canada, there's often a lot of denialism. We like to say that we're not a racist country, that some people say there's no systemic racism in Canada. But what he says is that these things are here, and this alleged attack shows that. This shows that people are still motivated by hate and that they're willing to kill innocent people because of it. And if people don't stand up and they don't fight hatred and they don't try to stop these things from happening and be proactive, then more lives will be lost.
Thanks, Justin.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.